Hey, and Ken and Lisa Lane here, the Mountain Gardeners. So we just share a garden center, family business. So your father started a garden center, the very first one in Prescott, Arizona. So Harold Waters. And so Ken and Lisa Lane, or Ken and Lisa Waters Lane, are the second generation owners that have come in. We've been doing this for 30 years now. So you just had your 29th anniversary. Congratulations. Last week. Yeah. Working the same job 29 years. Not many people do that.
True. I feel like it's been longer than 20. Not bad, but I guess growing up in it, you feel like this is like all you've ever really known.
It seems like just yesterday to me. So you raise the kids. I still have memories of getting, remember coffee cans, like old school metal coffee can, giving those to the boys and saying, boys, go get us some worms. We want to take them home or go fishing. We'll feed them to the fish or whatever. That's just yesterday. So the way things change, they're all grown up now. They've got families of their own, but in my head, it hasn't been 29 years. It can't be.
You know, it's funny. Kinsey, our daughter Kinsey asked me the other day, she goes, is Grampy sad? Cause I have three sisters, so four girls, no boys. She goes, is Grampy sad that there was no one to take on the Waters name forward? And I was like, I never asked him that.
I don't think so. He enjoys girls, so he just loves his daughters. So he just, I think he just knows God blessed him with girls, and he enjoyed that. And so we've been blessed with girls, three of them and one boy, and we just enjoy them. So I think it's kind of just enjoy what you're given and don't underappreciate them. Just appreciate them.
She was just curious.
She should ask him. She should ask him. So that'd be interesting. Anyway, we're digressing. Audience is kind of like bugging out right now. Like, who cares? What about the garden tips? What's going on? This is garden questions.
Well, hi.
Enough about the family.
If you insist, we'll talk about garden stuff. Well, Janine has a question. She wants to put in some pampas grass. She thinks it's very pretty, and it is, but she wants to know, is it invasive? If she puts in one, is she going to have six in the yard next year?
Is it invasive? It is not defined by the Arizona Department of Agriculture as an invasive species. We don't sell those here at the Garden Center, and we do offer pampas grass. Now, will it spread through the yard? Usually not. You're able to contain those. Mm-hmm. In fact, actually, most people hang on to their pampas grass too long. So it's a bunching grass. It tends to get about 3, maybe 4 feet across, and then it starts to die out in the middle. So really a pampas grass should be replaced every 10 years or so, 7, 10, somewhere in there. Mm-hmm. And then a new one should be put in if you want to keep that going. Otherwise, it tends to get mangy looking, looks scraggly. Mm-hmm. It can reseed every once in a while in the yard, but that's pretty rare. Usually, it just clumps further and further out, like a bamboo, only not as aggressive, not as invasive as bamboo. Bamboo's pretty bad. So, but I would say no. If you enjoy pampas grass, have one, enjoy it. Just realize it's not once and done. Mm-hmm. It's once and done for 10 years, and then you're probably going to replace it. Many of the pampas grass that are in your neighborhood, they should be dug up or they look rough.
They can start to look a little old, a little dated. Okay. Next question is also kind of related to the cold, but it's Russian sage. So after that last cold spell, Russian sage is kind of past its prime.
Oh, yeah.
Should you trim it back? Do you leave it through the winter time? What do you do with that?
So I would say pampas grass and autumn sage, those two, they've got a good shape to them. I would say enjoy. Yes, the foliage, it's actually stopped blooming a month ago. So you've seen the old flower stalks, been there. Your mind kind of envisions them, but it's not truly in bloom. Now the foliage is starting to turn yellow, starting to fade, starting to drop. But even without foliage, it's not in bloom. It's got a great shape, great vase shape to it. Mm-hmm. Just enjoy that. Don't be, it seems like second we get a frost, everyone's ready to go. I'm going to prune everything. I would say let the leaves drop, get done. I would say after the new year, then start pruning all that summer stuff. Don't feel like you're in a rush. In fact, there's some benefit to the landscape. the plants to leave that foliage up and insulate the heart of that plant through the coldest months, through February. Really, we don't prune ours, the autumn sage or the Russian sage, until March. Mm-hmm. We want to get past that coldest months. And then by March 1, it's pretty nice out. I mean, yeah, we can get some snow, but that cold, bitter January, like bone chilling kind of cold, mm-hmm. that's gone. Right. The ground isn't freezing. You can go ahead and prune back then. So don't feel like you're in a rush. Mm-hmm. Russian sage, though, impossible to kill. So just prune it whenever you want.
So I get a lot of people asking, you know, my maintenance man wants to cut my roses back. They want to cut my shrubs back. And I would, you know, it's hard to say, but I would encourage him to wait. Wouldn't you?
I would too. Ideally, if we're our yard, this is what we're Kennelisa Lane. We're just friends of yours. We're neighbors. We're talking over the back fence. And here's what we do. We don't have a maintenance company. We do it ourselves. Mm-hmm. We is a maintenance company. We do it ourselves a little bit over the years, but really spring blooming plants, do not prune those until they're done blooming. Forsythia, for lilacs, quince, rhododendrons, azaleas, all those things that bloom in the spring, camellias. Don't prune those until after they're done blooming. You're pruning those back in, you know, April and May when they're done blooming. If you prune them now, you're cutting off the flowers that you will enjoy next spring. The summer blooming things, Russian sage, hibiscus, Rosa's charons, crepe myrtles, smoke bush, all those things that bloom in the summer. Those we generally recommend wait till after the new year and then prune them between January 1 and March 31st. That first quarter of the year, it's best to prune and shape those. It goes for fruit trees, shade trees. Right now, there's still insects out. So if you're making prunes now through middle of December, insects can get into that cut and they can start, they spread disease. There's just some things that can happen. You're better off letting that sap, letting that tree actually slow down, go into stasis, just kind of go into slow motion. Then by then the bugs are killed off. And so you can start making cuts. You don't have to have fancy pruning paint when you do that, whereas you would if you're pruning it now. Yeah. That black paint tar. Tar kind of looking stuff. So there's an advantage to waiting. You can only go do better if you wait. You can only make a mistake if you go now.
Good advice.
That's kind of, there's a whole class on that. But there's the 90 seconds in a nutshell. Come see us for more.
Definitely. Angie would like to know, what's the difference, or is one better than the other, of putting shredded bark down or mulch down?
Gotcha. So that was a couple of weeks ago. Someone was asking that. Put something down, compost, something. And really, especially over, let's say, new plantings or roses or flower beds, what happens now through the end of the year? You'll get these nice warm days, cold nights, it'll freeze. Okay. So you get this freeze and thaw. And so the ground will actually crack. It'll actually, you see it expand. It gets fluffy. It heaves. This is what the industry term is. So you don't want your soil to heave because it also heaves the roots. It breaks the roots up. So by putting a 2 to 3 inch layer of some sort of organic material, compost, mulch, shredded bark, bark chips, whatever, it helps with that heaving. The benefit of shredded bark is it's cedar, so it tends to repel insects, so they won't tend to hibernate underground underneath those wood chips, whereas they might with compost or mulch or composted mulch kind of stuff. So that's the real benefit. It's light and airy, so you don't tend to, if we get a real heavy snow, it doesn't stay wetter. The moisture doesn't suffocate the crown. So there's some benefits to that. And it doesn't date your place. Your wood chips are so 1980s. So you just, they don't blow away, but they look kind of old school. The shredded bark composts better, easier. Personal preference, I don't know. But it's good to insulate that soil around the roots where the ground can heave. It's healthy for the plants. Okay. There you go. Went round in circles and said nothing. Kennelisa Lane, the Mountain Gardeners. Be right back after this.